Waste from nuclear power stations worries you, does it? Well, I've got a brilliant idea. We bury it deep underground under this hill, the one with the big house on top. You might think that I mean to irradiate all our federal politicians, but I suspect there's actually a law against that sort of thing. No, it's because nuclear waste is not a big problem. In fact, Sweden and Finland have been building underground repositories just recently. But I think this would be a great spot for an Aussie nuke store. Maybe even better than the one that the federal government has recently cancelled. I'll explain the science in a second, but imagine this. Those politicians who are anti-science and don't listen to the real science, the brilliant science about radiation, would be too scared to go to Parliament House and they would leave. That would leave us with only sensible politicians. What's there not to like about that? More about that later. Now, you've heard the story of the problem of nuclear waste disposal. It's some sort of intractable problem. Actually, it's no problem at all, and I'm being serious now. Here are some facts. Firstly, remember that you're receiving lots of radiation every day and you have been since birth. Rocks in the and the ground contain about 5 parts per million uranium, and 1% of that is the version that you make nuclear bombs out of. I calculate that my backyard has about 5 kilograms of uranium in the surface 1 meter of the soil. And there's a constant stream of radioactive particles that are coming down from space. This graph shows various sources of radioactivity that people in the United States are exposed to. There's radon coming from the ground from radioactive decay of uranium, especially in the closed rooms and basements, over 200 units. And I should say that on this graph, one unit is roughly what you would receive from living very close to a nuclear power station each year. 80 units you'd get from cosmic rays from space. But this is the funniest one. Our own bodies have radioactive elements inside us that produce far more radiation than exposure to a normal nuclear power station. That must make Green senators really conflicted. They irradiate themselves 29 times more than the radiation they get from a nuclear reactor. How can they live with themselves? Yeah. In fact, their self-generated radiation, largely from the potassium in their own bodies, is about a third of the maximum dose that one would have received from being next to the Three Mile Island nuclear disaster. So if you have two Greens and you throw in Mr. Anti-Nuclear Bone, you basically get a nuclear catastrophe. Anyway, let's have a look at radioactive waste. There are two types, very broadly. The highly radioactive stuff like nuclear fuel rods, the spent ones. Now, look, don't snuggle up to a spent nuclear fuel rod. You'll be killed for sure by that stuff. But then there's the low radioactive stuff, which is no real big problem. Things like spent clothes, old tools, parts from the dismantling of the building. Given that we're already receiving lots of radiation anyway, this is not a big problem. But one big point is this, that if something is highly radioactive, it won't last like that for millions of years. Radioactive materials have a half-life, the time that they decay to half their original radioactivity. The fact that something is highly radioactive is a good indication that the half-life is short. It's breaking down quickly. It can't decay at a high rate for very long because it will all be decayed. Now, that doesn't mean that spent fuel rods don't need to be sent away and looked after for a very long period of time, but they get progressively less and less of a problem with time. The thing about radioactive waste from reactors is that the quantity of material is extremely small. It is often said that the problem of waste from reactors has never been solved, and so the waste is just stored on the nuclear reactor site, some terrible problem that we're somehow avoiding. But it's actually the other way around. The quantity of waste is so small, so there's been no great urgency to solve the problem. You can just store it on site, at least for the time being. Now, compare that with other energy sources. Coal produces huge quantities of ash that is sufficient radioactivity that if it came out of a nuclear power station, it would be classified as low-grade nuclear waste. And then there's the carbon dioxide from burning coal. Yes, I know carbon dioxide is plant food. The second most important ingredient for agriculture after water. But there's this thing nowadays about carbon dioxide, which is now a worse reputation than uranium or even plutonium. But then there's the waste from solar cells and wind turbines, and this is in huge amounts, and it's often not very nice stuff, especially the waste from the manufacturer. They have cadmium, they have lead, and these things are very nasty and difficult to deal with. But the amount of waste from the nuclear power station is very small. So the best way in the end is just to stick it back in the underground. After all, the rocks underground are full of radioactive material. We're just adding a little bit to what's already there. Think about the mine that the uranium came from in the first place. Huge amounts of uranium, which is only partly recovered in the mining operation. The low-grade ore is just left there. You could bung the waste back in the mine, but it's actually not the best place. So back to the Parliament House nuclear waste repository. If we built a big cavern underground, down to a, say, a depth of 1 kilometre, which is not so hard to do with modern mining techniques, there would be between the cavern underground and, say, the Senate chamber, about 10,000 tonnes of natural uranium, working on rough figures, assuming a 1 cubic kilometre block of earth and 5 parts per million uranium, which is about average. 10,000 tonnes of uranium would contain about 100 tonnes of uranium-235, which is what they used to make the Hiroshima bomb with. Actually, it's enough to make 1,000 Hiroshima bombs or refuel 25 nuclear reactors sitting right under Parliament House right now. Ballpark figures, but you get the gist. And you thought those politicians were sometimes not telling everything? Hiding something, maybe? Yep, they're hiding 1,000 nukes under the building. Now, the waste cavern does not need to be particularly big. Australia would need to only bury about 40 trucks loads of waste every year if we converted all our electricity to nuclear. If we draw that to scale, it would be a 7-metre cube on its side. Now, I know people always talk about the problem of groundwater at a nuclear waste dump, where somehow the contaminated water can work its way to the surface. But one point that is always missed is that the groundwater is absolutely loaded with radioactivity. Before I was fired from James Cook University, we had quite a few projects looking at radionuclide traces. And my mate, Thomas Stieglitz, who did most of the work actually, he used to come over to my house because we've got a groundwater bore where we water the grass with. And he'd calibrate and test his radioactive monitoring equipment because my bore water was just loaded with radon. Anyway, Parliament House waste facility would be way deep down and there would be 1,000 Hiroshima bombs worth of uranium between the waste cavern and the Senate chamber. But despite the nuclear waste having no effect on the radiation at the surface, I bet you I could still sell Adam Bandt and Mr. Bowen a pair of lead-lined jocks. And it's not like these waste repositories are not popular in other countries. In Sweden, the newly created waste dump has extraordinary approval from the local residents, 86%. And that's because the locals realise that it's a small risk and that we're always receiving radiation from lots of other sources. It's about following the brilliant science of nuclear physics rather than the broken science of nuclear doom scaring, let's burn the witches type of pseudoscience. But look, 86% approval for a nuclear waste facility is nothing. The IPA did a survey of the residents of the small town, admittedly a metaphorical town, of Bungabula, and it found that 99% of residents said yes to the proposition of a nuclear waste facility in Canberra. And it would have so many other advantages. If there was a Polly who was misbehaving in Parliament, for instance.
I'm going to thank Mr. Speaker. Those people who are working out for
the Prime Minister resume his seat. Prime Minister resume his seat. Members will cease interjecting.
Simple solution. If the Honourable Member does not cease interjection, he will be taken down and tied up to a spent nuclear fuel rod for 3 days to think about his behaviour. The Green senators, I suspect, would be extremely well behaved, I think. But seriously, there are plenty of very good places for a nuclear waste facility in Australia. This is not an intractable problem because the amount of waste is minuscule compared with the amount of waste that a country produces every year anyway, and a lot of that stuff is nasty as well. We're continuously being exposed to lots of radiation, so just get over the fear doom-mongering and stop being a voodoo witch doctor and start following the brilliant science of nuclear physics and radiation safety.